Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to today's Joint National Park Service, United States Navy, Pearl Harbor Remembrance Ceremony. I'm David Ono, anchor at ABC 7 News in Los Angeles, and it is my pleasure to serve as today's Master of Ceremonies. The theme of this 82nd anniversary ceremony is Legacy of Hope. This morning, at this hallowed site, we remember the sacrifices of the brave men and women who earned the title of the greatest generation. The attack on Pearl Harbor on December 7, 1941, marked a pivotal epoch in world history. From that moment of infamy until the guns fell silent nearly 4 years later, our nation and the freedom-loving peoples of the world fought side by side. The wreckage of the USS Arizona remains as a monument to the events of World War II and to the legacy of those who sacrificed their lives to secure victory and preserve our most cherished values. The sculpture of the Tree of Life, chiseled in the side of the USS Arizona Memorial, reminds us that the ultimate prize of victory was not just the cessation of arms, but an expression of hope for the realization of a lasting peace. To our honored guests, the World War II veterans, please remain seated, while all other guests please rise as able for the arrival of the official party. The official party for today's ceremony includes Mr. Tom Leatherman, Superintendent, Pearl Harbor National Memorial, National Park Service. Captain, United States Marine Corps, arriving. Navy, Region Hawaii, arriving. United States Indo-Pacific. Side boys, post. Ladies and gentlemen, it is customary on December 7th that we observe a moment of silence at 7:55 to commemorate the beginning of the attack on Oahu. At 7:55, you will hear the sound of the USS Arizona ship's bell rung by Jay Sturdivant, National Park Service archaeologists, to mark the start of our moment of silence. Completing the moment of silence will be F-22 Raptors from the 199th and 19th fighter squadrons known as the Hawaiian Raptors executing a missing man formation. Ladies and gentlemen, may we observe a moment of silence. It was on that moment the attack in Pearl Harbor began 82 years ago today. Our thanks to the 199th and the 19th Fighter Squadrons for participating in today's ceremony. Please remain standing. Please remain standing as able this morning for the colors and the performance of our national anthem and Hawaii state song, Hawaii Pono'i. Bugler, sound attention. Color guard, parade the colors. Retire the colors. Color guard, retire the colors. Guests, please be seated. It is customary for ships passing the Arizona Memorial to pay their respects by rendering honors. Approaching, you will see the Arleigh Burke-class guided missile destroyer, the USS Decatur, commanded by Commander Matthew Furtado, a native of Rainham, Massachusetts. Today, in addition to rendering honors to the crew of the USS Arizona still entombed in their watery grave, the Decatur will also render honors to the Pearl Harbor survivors and World War II veterans, many who have gathered with us today. And this morning, we are honored to have with us Mr. Harry Chandler, a Pearl Harbor survivor who was serving as a hospital corpsman on the day of the attack. Mr. Chandler will face the Arizona Memorial representing all World War II veterans and return the salute to the USS Decatur as she passes close aboard. In recognition of the passing on of a legacy, Mr. Chandler will be joined in the contemplation circle by Cadet Brianna Tuggle of the Highland High School Junior ROTC and Cadet Sean Sereno of the McKinley High School Junior ROTC. Mr. Chandler, hand salute. Mr. Chandler, ready to. Carry on. And our thanks to Mr. Chandler for being with us today. Thank you very much for your service. We would also like to thank the crew of the USS Decatur, the Hawaii Air National Guard, and the United States Air Force for participating in today's ceremony. In the Hawaiian culture, the religious leader or spiritual advisor is known as a kahu. Today we are pleased to have for our invocation a Hawaiian blessing offered by Kahu Kikoa. Please welcome.
Ya Jehovah, ena aina apa, e malama ya Jehovah, meka hau oli, meka oli ana no kamea. Ua maikai o Jehovah, ua mauloa kona loko maikai. A me kona oia I oho I hanau na apa. Aloha e, aloha e. Aloha e. On this day of our 82nd commemoration of our ho'oilina o mana olana, our legacy of hope. Kia kua.
We always look to the future, and so we honor the past. We honor today 82 years ago, and we may our thoughts always be of hope for our generation and those beyond, as we honor those who have served, who have given the ultimate sacrifice, but those who continue to live on. So we pull this blessing on this day of remembrance with your aloha. Amene no kiaku apau. Amene, amene, amene. Mahalo.
Thank you, Kahe Kakoa. For over 40 years, the Japan Religious Committee for World Federation has offered a prayer for peace on this occasion. We are honored to have them once again with us for this ceremony. At this time, we would like to invite Mr. Fumio Shishino to the contemplation circle to offer the traditional prayer for peace, followed by the English translation by Mayumi Miyahara. Please welcome.
真珠湾攻撃から82年を迎える今日、日米両国の間に勃発した不幸な戦争によって亡くなられた多くの御霊に対し、謹んで哀悼の誠を捧げます。また、本年8月にマウイ島で発生した甚大なる火災被害により、
This year marks the 82nd year since the Pearl Harbor attack. We have all come together to pay our respect to those who sacrificed their lives when our country suffered from the tragedies of the war. We would also like to express our deepest condolences to those who were affected by the fires that broke out on the island of Maui this August.
私たち世界宗教、世界連邦日本宗教委員会は宗教者、信仰者が宗旨、宗派の垣根を越えて集い、心を一つに 世界平和を祈り、その実現のために日々活動しています。
Our organization, the Japan Religious Committee for the World Federation, have members from various religions and faith. Our mission is to bring true world peace.
1982年5月、ニューヨークの 聖ヨハネ大聖堂で日米宗教者会議が開催されました。その時と私たちはここパールハーバーに立ち寄り、粛々と頭を垂れ、慰霊の祈りを捧げました。その時以来私たちはハワイ平和記念使節団を毎年欠かすことなく派遣し、この慰霊式典に参加してまいりました。
In May 1982, we participated in the U.S.-Japan Religious Conference at St. Joe's Cathedral in New York City. On our way back to Japan, we made a stop at Pearl Harbor to pray for peace and offer our condolences. Ever since then, we are welcome back to here to pray for the peace.
しかしながら、 2019年12月より新型コロナウイルス感染症が世界中で猛威を振るい、この慰霊式典に参列がかなわない事態にまでなりました。本年はコロナ禍を乗り越え、平和記念施設派遣団 40回目を迎える意義深い訪問となります。
However, since December 2019, coronavirus has scared and spread around the world, which has made it impossible for us to visit and pray. This is our 40th visit at Pearl Harbor. It is a significant visit after overcoming the pandemic.
今もなお世界では疫病や戦争などの解決しがたい問題が山積しています。しかし私たちは今こそ世界平和の実現に向けて様々な困難に力を合わせ立ち向かわなければなりません。先人たちの努力、犠牲に心から敬意を表し、今こそ日米両国の関係のように国境、人種、宗派の垣根を越え、全人類が心を一つにして様々な問題に取り組む時です。
World peace continues to be quite fragile due to plagues, wars, and conflict. However, now is the time for us to work together to overcome various challenges to achieve world peace. We sincerely respect the effort and sacrifices made by our predecessors. And now is the time for all humankind to come together like we did with US and Japan to solve problems beyond borders, races, and religions.
祈ります。Let us pray for those who gave their lives for peace. Let us pray our deepest respect to the honorable souls. May they rest in peace. Let us pray for true peace in the world. May everyone on earth live in happiness. Let us become one family. Let us all live together with love and compassion. Let us devote ourselves for peace. May heaven guide us and show us the way. たかまのかむろ、かむろぎかむろみ、くしきみたまをさきはえたまえ。Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Today's event allows us, the generation of the 21st century, to recognize, honor, and give thanks to the generation of military veterans and civilians who served during World War II. Their lives and their legacy will never be forgotten. We are grateful to have veterans in attendance with us today from all around our great nation to commemorate Pearl Harbor Remembrance Day.And to honor us with their presence and their stories. Unfortunately, we recognize that we could not have all the veterans with us on site. Though they are not with us here, they are not forgotten. With that in mind, at this time, we would like to present a special welcome message from Lou Conter, a Pearl Harbor survivor who was stationed aboard the USS Arizona on the morning of December 7th.Lou will represent all the veterans who could not make it to today's ceremony, but who still hold a special place in our hearts and in our thoughts. Here's Lou.
Aloha. I wish I was there with you, Daniel, and all of your friends and your cadets. There's one thing you've got to remember, and that is remember Pearl Harbor. Thank you.
Thank you to Luke Hunter. For nearly two decades, the National Park Service and the United States Navy have partnered together to conduct this annual National Pearl Harbor Remembrance Day commemoration. So here to share an official welcome on behalf of the National Park Service is Tom Leatherman, Superintendent of the Pearl Harbor National Memorial. Mr. Leatherman has been working for the Department of the Interior for over 34 years, starting as a biological science intern in 1989 while still in college. Before moving to Hawaii, Mr. Leatherman served as superintendent at the four National Park Service historic sites in the San Francisco Bay Area, including Port Chicago Naval Magazine National Memorial and Rosie the Riveter World War II Homefront National Historical Park. On October of 2021, he arrived on Oahu as the permanent superintendent of the Pearl Harbor National Memorial. Please welcome Mr. Tom Leatherman.
Aloha and good morning. I want to open by acknowledging some of the dignitaries joining us today, who include the Governor of Hawaii, the Honorable Josh Green and his wife Jamie, Admiral John Aquilino, Commander of U.S. Indo-Pacific Command and his wife Laura and daughter Jess, Admiral Samuel Paparo, Commander of the United States Pacific Fleet, Admiral Stephen Barnett, Commander of Navy Region Hawaii and his wife, Naima. Randy Lavasser, Acting Regional Director of the National Park Service for Interior Regions 8, 9, 10, and 12. I'd also like to recognize the members of the Consular Corps and the Senior Executive Service. And lastly, I'd like to recognize all of the other flag and general officers, additional elected officials, appointed officials, and community leaders. E komo mai, welcome. It is my honor and privilege to co-host this annual commemoration event on Pearl Harbor Remembrance Day. Even more of an honor is getting to be in the presence of these amazing heroes to our country, the World War II veterans and the Rosie the Riveters and their families who join us today. Can we please give them a big round of applause? You inspire so many, including myself, and I thank you all for all that you've done in service to your country and for making it here to the ceremony this morning. For this 82nd anniversary of the attack on Oahu here at Pearl Harbor, I continue to be deeply grateful for the warm welcome and support everyone has given me since I arrived a little over 2 years ago. Most importantly, I want to acknowledge the unwavering support of our two key partners, Pacific Historic Parks and the U.S. Navy. Without these two partners, we would not be able to provide access to the memorial, support learning and education programs, and preserve this historic place so that we can truly honor those who served and whose lives were lost 82 years ago. Pacific Historic Parks makes events like this, like today possible, and they do so much more every day to help everyone experience this history through audio tours, virtual reality tours, education programming, and operating our gift shop. The United States Navy and specifically the Arizona Detachment share our mission of stewardship of the memorial. They operate the boats and provide access to the memorial and are unwavering in their support of our shared mission. It is clear to me that the relationship between our organizations is stronger than ever, and I look forward to continuing to build it even stronger in the years to come. I want to thank them both for their dedication and support. As each year passes, we say goodbye to more and more of our friends who served here on December 7th, 1941. Just last year, Jack Holder was seated in the front row participating in the event for his last time. Jack passed away earlier this year at the age of 100, and after a long and productive life, we missed having Jack here to share his stories with us, and remembering his service and sacrifice will help us carry on his legacy for years to come. As many of you know, there's only one USS Arizona survivor, and that's Lou, who just shared a message with us. Unfortunately, he was not able to make it out in person. Although Lou was not able to join us, like so many other people around the country, we hope that they are watching us live streamed on this program in the safety of their homes. Although it would be nice to have everyone here to attend, our legacy of hope does not require us to all be in one place to keep the history and memories alive. Together, we can continue to honor those who served and sacrificed by sharing the diverse stories and history related to the events from before, during, and after December 7th and the U.S. involvement in World War II. The legacy of hope at Pearl Harbor will be shared at this site and beyond for all time. We must never forget those who came before us and the events that led to this day 82 years ago, so that we can chart a more just and peaceful path for those who follow. I challenge each and every one of you to carry on the legacy of hope from Pearl Harbor, sharing the stories of valor and sacrifice you hear today with your friends and families, and instilling a sense of respect and inspiration in future generations. Only then will we truly honor those who lost their lives. It is my honor to serve as the superintendent here at Pearl Harbor National Memorial, and in my time here, I will do everything I can to ensure we honor and preserve this legacy for the years to come. Thank you.
Mr. Leatherman, thank you so much. The National Park Service shares the honor of serving as caretakers of the history of this hallowed ground with the United States Navy. Here to share an official welcome on behalf of the Navy and introduce our special guest speaker is Rear Admiral Stephen Barnett, Commander, Navy Region Hawaii. Please welcome.
Aloha. I'd like to welcome everyone, especially our veterans, our Rosie the Riveters. It's good to see you. It's truly an honor to be here with you and be able to thank you personally for your service to this great and awesome country. It's your legacy of service, that those of us serving today strive and try to emulate. My thanks, Tom, to you and your staff for this continued partnership. It's very important. It's important for this annual event and for countless other reasons. Thank you. Sounds good. Thank you for allowing us to conduct this ceremony from this beautiful site. Now it's my pleasure to introduce the guest speaker. He's a native of Huntington, New York, a graduate of the United States Naval Academy. He served in this Navy, our Navy, for 39 years. He's flown the F-14 Tomcat, as well as the F-18 Hornet. This Top Gun graduate has commanded at every level. At sea, he was a commander of Carrier Air Wing 2, Carrier Strike Group 2. While ashore, he served as U.S. Naval Forces Central Command, U.S. 5th Fleet Combined Maritime Forces, and the commander of the U.S. Pacific Fleet right here. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to introduce you to the 26th Commander of the U.S. Indo-Pacific Command, Admiral Aquilino.
Good morning and aloha. Okay, first thing, if you notice in your program, there's an insert that's got my picture on it. That's because I injected myself late into this program. I wasn't supposed to be here today. So I want you to know that it was incredibly important for me to be able to attend and participate in this event. Number one, because all of our veterans are here. This is the largest group that we've had since COVID, and it's incredibly important for you to be here and for me to recognize you. But second, this potentially is my last Pearl Harbor day in uniform, as sometime in 24, I too will retire. So to our veterans, thanks for letting me participate. To Admiral Barnett, thanks for letting me steal the podium. And for those who are in here, later today, Admiral Barnett will be promoted to 2-star based on the recent release of our promoted flag officers. BD, congratulations. Governor and Jamie, thank you. Thanks for all you do for our service members here living in this amazing place. Thank you. To all of the distinguished visitors, the Consul General call, the representatives of all nations who participate, it's incredibly nice of you to be here and recognize this day with us. For the flag officers, friends, partners, families, and all who attended, thank you very much for your participation today. There's a couple of admin items I would want to touch before I make some comments. First, at this time, we always remember Pearl Harbor, the day that lives in infamy. But there are a couple of other critical events that are amazingly important to the United States Navy specifically and some friends and families in Hawaii. On December 6th of 2019, we lost two civilian heroes at the shipyard. Mr. Augustin and Vince Capoy Jr. And I never come to this event or during this time of year without remembering those heroes, without remembering their families. It does us service to remember them as well, and I do it every year at this time. So if you would, not only for the Augustins and the Capoys, but also for Admiral Dick Mackey, who had my job a number of years ago that we lost 1 year ago on December 7th. So if you would join me in a moment of silence for those heroes, please. Thank you. Thank you very much. I also want to thank the Mustang Association and the Chiefs, as well as Tom and the Park Service, for what they've done most recently on Arizona Memorial and making her look as wonderful as she does today. So for the Chiefs team, who always get things done, and for the Mustang Association, our former Chiefs, I thank you for taking care of this amazing place. Thanks. Okay, we do this every year, but it is not a normal day. It's just not another day we come up and remember. What I want you to do today with me is, as you look out over the water, envision what it would have been like. There are numerous veterans here that got to watch it in person. For the rest of us, I want you to imagine it. 82 years ago on this day, Sunday morning, a day a lot like today with trade winds partly cloudy, 71 degrees. And what was seen? The sight of enemy aircraft, fires on ships, buildings, people running frantically, people sweating, covered in blood. That was real. That day, the sounds of propellers whizzing, gunfire bursts, bullets striking metal, pavement, people, alarms going off. That was real. The smell of a battle, black smoke, burning rubber, fuel, gunpowder. That was real. The emotional feelings that only you have witnessed and experienced, and we can only imagine, of shock, fear, terror, confusion, sorrow, anger, and despair. Those were real for you. Today's survivors and the team who supported that war effort experienced it. But we have to imagine it, and we have to never forget it. The greatest generation is with us here today. World War II veterans, Rosie the Riveter's team who supported the war effort, we are humbled by your presence and thankful for your service and sacrifice. The commitment of and courage of that team is what we all strive for today. I told you to imagine it. I ask you to talk to them later and hear it directly from them. Mr. Ed Carroll, 98 years old, came here from Utah to be here for this day. During the attack, he was a 16-year-old airplane mechanic on Ford Island. He watched the USS Arizona take a hit. He grabbed his rifle and stood the duty and defended this island and our nation. During the war, he became a Navy pilot to continue the fight, just from a different seat. Kenneth Stevens, 100 years old, came here from Oregon today. During the attack, he was on USS Whitney. It took strafing gunfire, and he immediately manned his battle station. Amid the fire and smoke on his ship, he helped his buddies swim through the black tar-like oil to safety. Ira Eichschaub, 103, also came from Oregon. He was 21 years old, a musician in the band aboard the USS Dobbin. When the attack came, he began saving and rescuing the survivors and took those casualties ashore. Herbert Elfring, 101, came from Michigan. An Army private in the 251st Artillery Regiment. During the attack, he was over at Barber's Point. As enemy bullets strafed the camp, they missed him by just a number of feet. Harry Chandler, 102, came here from Florida today. Harry wanted to join the Navy so bad he enlisted before graduating high school. And during the attack, he was a corpsman at the Navy hospital. During the attack, he rushed to the hospital amongst all of the carnage and delivered medical care for all who needed it. Sterling Kale, 102, and a Hawaii local. He's the last survivor that lives here on Oahu. During the attack, he was 20 and a Navy pharmacist. He also just finished the Navy Frogman course on underwater demolition. He and his teammates rescued 46 sailors from the burning waters of Oklahoma and Arizona. And after the attack, he helped bring forward 100 of those sailors who had given their lives from the wreck of Arizona. He also served as a corpsman in the 1st Marine Division, and he deployed to Guadalcanal, where he there saved and triaged both Marines and Japanese sailors and prisoners. Lastly, he shifted to the Army, and he fought in the Korean War and the Vietnam War. Our other World War II veterans in attendance, Bob Lee, Art Shack, Archie Holte, Cash Barber, John Hamamoto, Alan Chatwin, Joe Maxfeld, Wendell Newman, and Rosie the Riveter team, Gene Gibson, Marion Wynn, Caroline Kilgore, Lucille McDonald, Clarice Lafrendiere, Dolores Leonard, Delphine Claput, Virginia Bassler. We honor your service to our nation, and we must never forget it. There were many things that today we look back on and try to remember and learn from Pearl Harbor. First, victory was not certain, not by any means. And while our nation was surprised, the courage of our military responders sitting here today makes us understood they were ready to fight with what they had. And I think if you'd talk to them, they'd send these messages to us. Number one, remember Pearl Harbor. Number two, keep America alert. Number three, constant vigilance is needed to defend our nation and our way of life. And lastly, we must be ready to fight and win. Today, for those of us in uniform who serve, and for those civilian warriors who support our incredible Department of Defense, we stand on the shoulders of these giants in front of us. Today, the joint force, made up of soldiers, sailors, airmen, Marines, Coast Guardsmen, Guardians, we operate every day alongside our allies and partners to defend democracy and to ensure a free and open Indo-Pacific. For those veterans and Rosie the Riveters who sit here today, our message to you is we are vigilant. We are ready. We will never forget. And today, we stand the watch. We're honored to be in your presence. Thank you very much.
Wonderful speech, Admiral. Thank you very much. Now I would like to introduce our keynote speaker, Captain Ray Hauer of the United States Marine Corps. Captain Hauer is a native of San Diego, California. He earned his Bachelor of Science in Supply Chain Management from the University of Kansas in May of 2016 and was commissioned as a second lieutenant through the ROTC program. Captain Hauer earned his Wings of Gold on the 1st of May, 2020. And was assigned to fly the AV-8B Harrier at Marine Corps Air Station Cherry Point, North Carolina. After completion of transition training in the Harrier with VMAT 203, he joined the Bulldogs of VMA 223 in July of 2021, where he served in operations. In addition to his flying duties, Captain Hauer currently serves as the Squadron Logistics Officer. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in a warm welcome for Captain Ray Hauer.
Sorry, there's a lot of binders up here. Well, I'm not going to lie, it's going to be pretty hard to follow up the Admiral after that, but bear with me. Pearl Harbor survivors, World War II veterans, distinguished guests, and ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Pearl Harbor. What a beautiful day, and what a special place to spend this Thursday morning. Thank you for joining us today to remember the events that occurred here 82 years ago, and to honor those who served. When you saw the program this morning, I'm sure many of you wondered why a 29-year-old Marine Corps captain was selected to be the keynote speaker here today. And I don't blame you, because when Mr. McCoy from the 82nd Commemoration Planning Committee asked me to speak, I wanted the same thing. One thing I knew for sure is I wasn't selected for my speaking ability. So why am I up here? Well, when Mr. McCoy informed me the theme for the remembrance ceremony today was Legacy of Hope, it became clear. For those of you who have read the program, bear with me. For those of you who haven't, let me introduce myself and perhaps answer that question. My name is Captain Ray Hauer. I'm a Marine Corps AVAP Harrier pilot. I'm the son of Colonel Ray Hauer, a Marine Corps F-4 Phantom Rio and F-18 Hornet pilot. I am the grandson of Lieutenant Colonel Ray Hauer, a Marine Corps A-4 Skyhawk pilot who flew combat missions in Vietnam before losing his life in service to our country. I am also the great-nephew of Lieutenant Commander Louis Contour, a Navy PBY Catalina pilot who flew in the Pacific during World War II. At 102 years old, my Uncle Lou is the last surviving crew member of the USS Arizona that lies beneath these waters. As I stand before you, I represent them and their legacy. The cufflinks and captain's bars I'm wearing today are my father's. The Eagle Globe and anchors on my collar and cover are my grandfather's. And the wings of gold I wear upon my chest are the very wings my Uncle Lou earned on November 15th, 1942. I am proud to be a third-generation Marine Corps pilot and naval aviator. That is why I'm up here with you today. As you think about the theme, Legacy of Hope, one can't help but wonder, what were the hopes of those serving in and around Pearl Harbor prior to and after the attack? I imagine as many went to sleep Saturday night, their hopes were the same as many of the service members serving all over the world today. Some went to sleep hoping for a good night's rest, or simply just a good breakfast in the ship's mess in the morning. Some hoped to make the service a career, others hoped to do their tour of duty and return home. I'm sure some hoped the U.S. would be able to stay out of the war. Some just hoped the Chicago Bears would defeat the Chicago Cardinals that Sunday. Perhaps there were even a few who had a little too much fun Saturday night, and they just hoped the room would stop spinning. But at 7:55, Sunday morning, December 7th, as these skies were blackened with the first wave of 183 Japanese aircraft, and the morning quiet was disrupted by the roar of their engines, those hopes were dashed. As the bombs fell and their torpedoes swam through these waters en route to their target, those hopes were dashed. As the explosions began and the very skies, as the explosions began and the skies filled with smoke and flames, and this very harbor in front of you was set ablaze, those hopes were dashed. And the calls from the injured and dying, to the commands to man battle stations and free lines, to the crackling of return fire and a fleeting attempt to thwart the attack, those hopes were dashed. In a moment, the hopes of Saturday night were replaced by a new hope, a more urgent hope, the hope to survive. The next day, Congress declared war. Our nation, that was not ready for and wanted no part of a war, found itself at war. Our Pacific fleet had to be rebuilt, and the war machine necessary to achieve victory had to be constructed. Those that survived that initial attack were joined by volunteers from across our nation, and as the stories of their courage and valor on the seas, in the skies, and on the battlefields around the globe, it brought new hope, a hope for victory. Our nation rallied behind the troops in their determination. At home, from the cities, farms, and factories across our country, everyone was encouraged by their spirit and sacrifice to provide the materials, tools, and financial resources necessary to support the war effort. Through the hope the troops created, our nation came together as never before or since, and the greatest generation was born. Our country is united in purpose, and with the help of our allies, was ultimately victorious in turning back evil. But they weren't done. After years of war, our nation and the world needed rebuilding and healing. Those that fought for our freedom returned home and threw themselves into that task with the same determination. The legacy of hope that was born here at Pearl Harbor, grown throughout the war and blossomed, and out of the devastation, it paved the way for a new hope, the hope for a just and lasting peace. Sharing in that hope, Japan, once our most reviled enemy, ultimately became one of our staunchest allies. People around the world longed for a lasting peace. 51 countries joined together in an effort to build such a peace. Today, we strive for that lasting peace. As Americans, we're almost all descendants of the greatest generation, and we have inherited their legacy of hope. It is incumbent upon us to honor it, learn from it, and carry it forward to make our world a more peaceful place. With that legacy also comes the responsibility to stand ready to defend peace. For those of you that served in the past, know this. The men and women who wear the nation's uniforms today take that duty as seriously as you did all those years ago. Today, we remember Pearl Harbor and pay tribute to the 2,390 Americans who died here. We reflect on their acts of courage and heroism, both told and untold. We mourn their loss and the lives they never got to live. As we honor them, we also remember that Sunday, December 7th, was just day one. Those that survived day one went on to serve all around the globe, drawing from the strengths from the memories and the sacrifices of those who never left these islands. Many survivors of that infamous Sunday ultimately perished in far-off lands. Others survived the 4 years of war to eventually return home, and we are honored and blessed to have some of them with us here today. It has been 82 years since that fateful Sunday morning. That is quite literally a lifetime ago. With each passing day, we lose more of our greatest generation. It won't be long before these true heroes that are with us today and at home will only live in our hearts, memories, and history books. So it is only fitting that I close by thanking you. Whenever my Uncle Lou or any other veteran of World War II is recognized or thanked for their service, they humbly answer, "We just did what we had to do." Fair enough, but the fact that you did it, the sacrifices you made, the courage and heroism you showed, the determination to succeed that you demonstrated, the lives sacrificed by the fallen, the legacy that you all built remains unmatched and a lesson that keeps on teaching. Let there be no misunderstanding. Without you just doing what you had to do and the victory you won for us all, we would not enjoy the freedom, opportunity, and prosperity we have today. On behalf of a grateful nation, I thank you for the gifts you have given us and the legacy we inherit. May God bless you all, and may God bless America.
Captain Howard, thank you so much. Beautiful speech. Thank you for your service and your family's continued service. So this morning, we will place wreaths to honor the territory of Hawaii, Army, Marine Corps, Navy, Air Force, Space Force, and Coast Guard. The wreaths will be presented by active duty and guard service members, National Park Service Rangers. And this year, in keeping with the theme of passing on this endearing legacy to our future generations. The wreath presenters will be joined by members of the local McKinley High School Junior ROTC, cadets of the Civil Air Patrol, and all the way from Sparta, Ohio, cadets from the Junior ROTC unit of Highland High School. The wreaths you're about to see presented are an expression of our gratitude and a symbol of our unending appreciation of service and sacrifice. Today, with these wreaths, we honor all of our heroes, military and civilian, who lost their lives on December 7, 1941. This formation, moving from the Remembrance Circle, which preserves the names and memories of each American who lost their lives on December 7, 1941, represents our past and present. It honors those who fought in the name of freedom 82 years ago and recognizes the veterans and current active duty members who continue to serve our country with honor, courage, and commitment. The wreaths will be placed in the Contemplation Circle as an indelible reminder of the legacy of these service members and civilians, and the hope that every future generation never forgets the many sacrifices that make freedom possible. The bell from the USS Arizona will sound in honor of the sacrifice of each service. We remember the territory of Hawaii. On that fateful morning, we remember the 49 civilians who lost their lives as a result of the attack. As a base for all of the military services, the then territory of Hawaii and its citizens played a major role in one of history's greatest salvage and repair efforts, quickly restoring most of the damaged ships and expediting their return to the fleet. Hawaii citizens opened their homes and businesses to servicemen stationed in the islands and to those returning from war patrols. Today, the state of Hawaii remains a strategic and welcoming home port for our military. Continuing to offer aloha to all. Representing the territory of Hawaii is Senior Airman Tavin Lorenzo of the Hawaii Air National Guard, Ranger Joe Borgia from the National Park Service, and Cadet Seth Vanta from the McKinley High School Junior ROTC. We remember the United States Army. While many history books tend to focus on the Pearl Harbor attack, the brave members of the United States Army fought diligently to defend their posts on December 7th, 1941. In total, 233 soldiers were killed during this surprise attack. Today, from Schofield Barracks to Bellows Airfield, the U.S. Army stands ready to defend our nation and maintain a steadfast presence on Oahu. Representing the United States Army is Corporal Zachary Fletcher, Ranger William Crow for the National Park Service, and Cadet Christina Acelador from the McKinley High School Junior ROTC. Representing the United States Marine Corps. Many may not realize until visiting the USS Arizona Memorial that a United States Marine detachment made up part of each battleship's crew. A total of 109 Marines lost their lives that day. 105 perished aboard ships in Pearl Harbor, and 4 were killed in action at the ever-mooring mast field. Today's Marine continues the tradition of serving our nation whenever and wherever they are called upon. Their commitment to self-sacrifice and dedication provide a cornerstone for our nation's defense and the challenges of the 21st century. Representing the United States Marine Corps is Captain Riley Jones, Ranger Kara Jones from the National Park Service, and Cadet Megan Decker from the Highland High School Junior ROTC. We remember the United States Navy. ...1,999 sailors lost their lives in the December 7th attacks on Pearl Harbor and Naval Air Station Kaneohe Bay. Many sailors met their final resting place in the waters directly behind me while defending their ships and helping their shipmates escape the burning waters. Many more assisted in rescue and recovery efforts in the days and weeks that followed. The sailors of today's Navy continue to serve with honor, courage, and commitment to protect our nation's interests at sea. Alongside America's allies and partners, they stand ready to provide maritime defense, preserve economic prosperity, and keep the seas open and free. Representing the United States Navy is Chief Maximilian Kestner, Ranger G.G. Kestner from the National Park Service, and Cadet Riley Dewart from the Highland High School Junior ROTC. We remember the United States Air Force. Though not yet a service in 1941, the United States Air Force was formerly referred to as the Army Air Forces, and here in Oahu as the Hawaiian Air Force. On December 7th, Lieutenants Ken Taylor and George Welch scrambled to their aircraft park at Haleiwa Field and took off to brave the skies against incredible odds. Today, airmen serving in the United States Air Force in Hawaii continue the legacy of the defense of America's vital airspace interests around the globe. Representing the United States Air Force is Airman First Class Molly Manuel Fernandez, Ranger Jason Okasra from the National Park Service, and Cadet Noah Araki from the Civil Air Patrol. We remember the United States Space Force. America's newest military branch, United States Space Force, carries the proud legacy of the Army Air Forces as guardians of America's interests around the globe. They represent the latest example of carrying on the legacy of the generations of Americans we honor today. The Space Force guardians in the Indo-Pacific stand vigilant to safeguard American assets in orbit from physical and digital attack in the ever-changing challenges of the 21st century. Representing the United States Space Force is Tech Sergeant Casey Mastel, Ranger Stanley Sindridi from the National Park Service, and Cadet John Salvador from the Civil Air Patrol. We remember the United States Coast Guard. At the time of the attack, U.S. Coast Guard vessels in Hawaii were all stationed in Honolulu. At 6:45, the patrol craft Tiger intercepted a dispatch from USS Ward that claimed destruction of a submarine. Later, Tiger itself came under enemy fire as it participated in the defense of Oahu. The United States Coast Guard continues to serve as America's frontline agency for enforcing the nation's laws at sea, protecting the marine environment, and providing life-saving services. Representing the United States Coast Guard is Chief Taylor Stern, Ranger Sarah Ann Alexander from the National Park Service, and Cadet Alyssa Regals from the Highland High School Junior ROTC. At this time, the wreath presenters representing today's generation of veterans will salute the greatest generation for their service and their legacy. Would all Pearl Harbor survivors and all of our World War II veterans please remain seated so that we and all who are present here today can honor you. We acknowledge that on December 7, 1941, and in the years that followed, you executed your duties at your posts and weathered the storm of war. It is because of you and all those who served 82 years ago that we enjoy freedom and liberty in this great country today. Will everyone else please stand and join me in expressing our appreciation. A grateful nation applauds you. Ladies and gentlemen, if you could remain standing for the benediction and the Marine Corps rifle salute. At the conclusion of the rifle salute, a bugler from the United States Pacific Fleet Band will blow taps from the contemplation circle. A second bugler will echo the call from the remembrance circle, symbolizing our commitment to always remember the lives lost on that day and to carry on their legacy of hope, for the defense of freedom and lasting peace. Captain Gary Thornton, Navy Region Hawaii Chaplain, will now offer the benediction.
Good morning and aloha, ladies and gentlemen. Please join me in this prayer of benediction. Let us pray. Almighty, gracious, and loving God, thank you for your presence here today and for each of these in attendance, especially our Pearl Harbor survivors and World War II veterans. Pearl Harbor is a sacred place, a place of remembrance. It is a national shrine. Immortal One, we will never forget what happened here 82 years ago today. It was a date which lives in infamy. But may it now serve as and inspire in us a legacy of hope as we look to the future for peace. Members of what many call the greatest generation, many of whom were on that day, among other things, preparing to worship you, instead paid the ultimate price. They made the supreme sacrifice, the giving of their lives, and at a time when we were not at war. In these serene surroundings, we are reminded of that day and of their heroic exploits. We still mourn the loss of our shipmates, of all service members, and yes, civilians who died here. They are always and ever in our memory. For we who follow in the tradition of naval service, and for all who are in the armed forces, may we demonstrate the courage, bravery, and patriotism of our fallen forefathers. May we remain true to our calling to protect and defend our homeland and to promote the cause of freedom and democracy for all. Lord, may we also continue to be firmly committed to peace, safety, and the well-being of our partner nations and allies. And on this day, may we not lose sight of the fact that he who was once our enemy is now our friend. Even so, guard us against complacency. Help us to remain vigilant and in a continued state of readiness to address current geopolitical threats to our way of life and the liberty we enjoy. Eternal Father, we would be remiss if we did not close this prayer asking that you would be with our brave warriors, men and women, even now deployed and in harm's way. Protect them, grant them strength, and be with their loved ones. Once again, Lord, we give you thanks, asking that you would bless us and keep us, that you would make your face to shine upon us and be gracious unto us, that, Lord, you would lift up your countenance upon each and every one of us and grant us your peace now and always. This we pray in your most holy name. Amen.
Captain, thank you so much. Stand by for rifle salute. Side boys, post. On behalf of the National Park Service and the United States Navy, thank you for attending today's observance of the 82nd anniversary of the attack on Oahu, and for continuing to remember and honor the sacrifices made by those who served here on December 7th, 1941. To those who are watching our ceremony through our online broadcast, we also extend our sincere aloha. Thank you to the Defense Media Activity for providing the live stream. This ceremony would not have been possible without the critical assistance of Pacific Historic Parks. Please remain standing for the departure of the official party. United States Indo-Pacific Command, departing. Navy Region Hawaii, departing. Captain, United States Marine Corps, departing. Mr. Tom Leatherman, Superintendent, Pearl Harbor National Memorial, National Park Service, departing. Ladies and gentlemen, this concludes our ceremony. Please take a moment to meet our veterans in attendance and offer a personal expression of gratitude for their service, their sacrifice, and for not giving us, and now for giving us the opportunity to honor them here today. Please enjoy the patriotic music performed by the United States Pacific Fleet Band as you depart. We hope you enjoy the rest of your day. Thank you for coming. Mahalo.